right, this is a little bit difficult to show on camera. What I have here is a standing surface that is a chalkboard with a magnet. So you can actually magnet on, it's got magnet paint on here. Plus I've used chalkboard paint and stenciled with the chalkboard paint as well. So you could actually write notes and things like this on here. We've got a dry brush chicken, and we've got a bella cucina word, which means beautiful kitchen in Italian, and a stand that you put it in. When you stand it up, it's in your kitchen, and you know it makes a nice little standing chalkboard thing. But to break it down, you just take out the words, take out the chicken, take out the chalkboard, sorry. And then I also did just chalkboard and today's menu on the other side. So then you could reverse it if you wanted to. Reverse that, put that in there. And when I ever get it done, you could supplement something like Santa's sleigh in the front. So now you have some cute alternate type things. So you could put in chicken for regular time of the year and then Santa for the other time. All right, I've got my brand new kitchen words stencil, and I'm gonna wanna make it sticky on the back side so that I don't get any bleed under, because lettering is only cool if lettering is really clean, and I want this really clean. So I'm gonna take my 2-inch roller, and this is tack it over and over. Okay, so it is a temporary adhesive, and it's much nicer than a spray, because a spray, number one, it doesn't go as far as this, but number two, it is, you know, bad for the environment, bad for your lungs, bad for everything around it. So we're just going to roll this onto our roller. I've got a piece of wax paper here, and then I'm going to go ahead and just apply an even coat all over. And then I'll take it off of the wax paper to dry. So I'll lift it off and I'll just lay it onto something else, like a couple bottles of paint or something like that. And I'll let it dry until it's clear. And of course I'll tack it all over, and then it'll be ready to use. Now, as I'm putting this on, the last little thing I'll do is smooth it out, because the thicker the tack it, the more sticky it is. And I don't like it super sticky. So the thinner you apply it, the better it is. Okay, and look at that, nice stenciled words with tack it. I'm gonna just fold that over, find a place for this right on my water basin there. Okay, and then the other thing I have is I have another little stencil that will need a little bit of tack it as well. And this one is my menu stencil. Okay, so it's got three different styles of menu all in different directions. And so what I like to do when I've got my roller dirty and stuff is I like to just go ahead and get everything that I need tacked up, tacked. And if your tack it wears out because you've used your stencil too much, then you can just reapply it right over the top. And cleanup for this is really easy. You're going to go right to your sink and you're going to clean it up with water right away. You don't want to wait, because then you'll have just a tacky sponge, and that won't be any fun at all. So so then you just do everything at once and clean up right away, and you're good to go. All right, two products that DecoArt has come out with that are just amazing products. One is chalkboard paint. This, now I did a test, it's on my blog someplace, but I did a test between chalkboard paint, plain black paint, and the clear chalkboard that you can put over regular colors. And hands down, the easiest that acted the most like a chalkboard was the chalkboard paint. Plain black paint didn't erase very well, and the chalkboard varnish, it worked really well. It was second place, but this was hands down the best. Okay, and then the other product they have is a glass chalkboard paint, which is really cool as well. Today I'm not going to talk about glass, but I wanted to let you know that it existed. And we're going to go ahead and just do chalkboard paint on our chalkboard. So shake that puppy up. Mine's been sitting on a shelf for a little while. The first thing that I want to do, I'm on my nonstick mat, my extra large nonstick mat, and what I want to do is I want to get into these little curlicue cutouts. So the very first thing I'm going to do is stipple with my Italian sash brush, which gets down into those little groovies. I haven't found a brush that works as well as this. You do have to do just a little bit of patching, but this gets right on in there because of the length and the way that the bristles are made. I'll just set that off to the side, and I'll take my roller. I'm a big fan of 2-inch rollers. And we're going to load that brush, and then we are going to apply a nice even coat of our chalkboard paint. We'll do a couple coats. and get it nice and smooth. I want to smooth out those bumps from where I did the stippling. Get that nice and smooth, do a couple coats, letting it dry in between coats, and we're going to do the back side too, but we're going to do something special to that. Alright, you need to talk about the way that this piece goes together. This is a standing surface. This bottom row right here, the bottom quarter inch, goes into a slot or a groove. You can take it out to write on the chalkboard, erase it, clean it, store it. But once we get our first coat of paint on here, we're going to want to measure this and tape it off so we don't build up layers on it. If you build up layers and it'll end up too thick, and you'll have to sand in between the grooves to get it to fit. The other thing we want to be careful with the chalkboard, see how this is very bumpy right here? With a roller, you just roll off some of your paint onto a paper towel. You can go back and gently, without pushing, you can hear how it sounds different. You can even out the bumps, and that's what you're going to want to do. Okay, we don't want high, big, giant, bumpy things that we have to sand. It's just going to be not right for our chalkboard. Okay, and we'll go ahead and we'll let that dry, and we'll do the other side. When you're doing this, you can elevate it onto your painter's pyramids for drying. You can flip it over and dry both sides, do both sides at the same time. So I'll get that up there, move it off to the side, clean up my mess, and get ready for the other side. Okay, on the reverse side, I'm going to go ahead and make this bottom area black. I'm going to dry it and paint it off, or tape it off. I'm going to stipple in here to make sure I get that all awesome how I want it. And then I'm going to apply magnet paint to the underneath part of that once I tape this off. If you put magnet paint on, you do three coats of magnet paint and then you cover it with your chalkboard. Then you'll have a magnetic chalkboard anywhere you want it. Okay, so we're going to take our magnet paint. And what I like about having this in the craft size is honestly, you know, you don't need a $30 gallon of magnet paint to do a project. So this is nice and handy. You can put magneticability wherever you want. So you're just going to stir it. This is mine from, I think, gosh, the last one that I did was the roses, the yellow roses, which might have been a year ago. Long time. So it's not really separated, and it's still, it's not all dried up and everything. There are actual iron filings and stuff like that down in there, so you do want to mix them in your paint or you're not going to get good magnetization. I can think of about 800 versions of magnet words, and they're all incorrect. Okay, so we're going to put some of that out on our palette. Okay, and we are going to go ahead and use our roller in this material. Because we do want to keep it smooth, and the roller is the way to go if you want to keep it smooth. And then we're just going to put three nice, even coats, not too thin. We want them kind of thicker than we would normally do, and that's not hard because this product is a little bit thick. But you can see it goes on really nicely. So what we're going to do is magnetize the surface with this the metal filings in this paint, and then we're going to go over the top of it with the chalkboard paint. And I have another couple surprises in store as well. So we'll get that all evenly done. And I'll go and roll it smoothly just to get a nice even application. I think you're supposed to wait, if I read my label correctly, I think you're supposed to wait, dry 1 hour between each of the coats, and then you let it dry completely for 24 hours before you do other stuff to it. Okay, so make sure you read your labels always, always, always. And we'll let this dry once we get it coated, and we'll be good to go for another coat in about an hour. All right, now I'm going to get a couple of coats. I sanded my surface with my sanding disc, and you just take it and run it across. Just it got a little pebbly, and then you wipe off your dust with, dust and chunks of stuff. That was from cleaning up my nonstick craft mat. So you wipe off the chunky stuff just to make it nice and smooth, because when you're doing a chalkboard, that's what you want. And then we're going to go ahead and apply a couple of coats, nice and even, and I think probably two coats is probably sufficient. You always do manufacturer suggestions, so if it says more, do more. All right, and get it nice and even. Oh, and you know what I forgot? I forgot that I want to tint this. So I'm going to go ahead and mix in just a little bit of white with my black chalkboard stuff. I'm going to presume that this will work, and I don't know that it's a fact. Oh, actually, you know what? Let's see, do I want to do it that way? Yeah, okay, we'll tint it with just a little bit of white. I'm thinking on my feet here. A little bit more. So maybe that's a penny for this big pile. I want it to be almost black, where my black letters will show up. So I'm going to put this as a gray chalkboard, and I'm going to put black letters over the top. And it could work just as well the other way, but we'll see. Okay, so now I'll go into that and go over the area that I already did. I think the black will show okay. We'll have to see. I may be base coating this one more time if it doesn't work out. Okay, then I'll go ahead and roll back over for smoothness. So just gently roll. No pressure to get a fine pebble. Okay, it looks really pebbly on the monitor. But we want even, fine, pebbly stuff. So sometimes there's like a method to working things a little bit longer than you'd think that you might need. Okay, we'll let that dry and we're gonna do one more coat. Okay, I've laid my stencil over. I had done a test on the previous thing. I want this to be really, really tone on tone. So let me get this over here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to stipple into my black chalkboard paint, and then I'm going to pounce off over here on my piece of palette paper. Okay, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to do it very soft, tone on tone through this. This is a jumbo dauber, and these are washable, so I'll just go and wash it out when I'm done. And maybe I might want it stronger black on the edges and more faded in the middle, so maybe I'll pounce off a little bit more. You can totally peek to see if you're liking it. I've got my tack it over and over on there. If there's a possibility of going over your edge, then what you want to do is just put a piece of tape down there. Here in the middle, and I'll pounce off. And that just controls what you got going on. Treat each word separately so that you are sure that you got it, especially if your stencil is dirty like that. Okay, so you don't want to go over it twice because then you'll make it really strong. You don't want there to be an irregularity in your stenciling because you want the evenness of tone. So be careful of that too. One thing, yeah. Okay, so I think the rest is fairly standard. Okay, I peeked out from under and I think I'm going to want it to all be fairly black. So I'll just go ahead and go right over the top one more time. So we'll go ahead and find a little corner here and lift her off. Okay, look how cool that is. Awesome. I love stencils. Okay, they just make my work so much easier. All right, I'm gonna let that dry. We're gonna roll on the base coat for the chicken. And the reason we're gonna roll on the base coat is because we're gonna do dry brushing. And dry brushing needs a little bit of texture and tooth. We can't get texture and tooth on this very fine masonite, so we have to have to apply a little bit of texture and tooth to our chicken with a roller. And we don't want to over roll this. In this case, we want to let it be as chunky as it can be, but even is what you want for texture, is you want really, really even, pebbly texture. And it'll probably take two coats to get what I'm looking for, so. Okay, and I'm not going to worry too much about those edges. They're very dark as it is. If your edges aren't, then use the stippling brush thing to make them be the dark color that you want. Okay, as my paint bottle gets empty, because I have my labels on top of these paints and my little paint swatch, I don't want to redo them. So what I'll do is I'll just swap out the lids. And now my labels stay good and I can keep all of my paints, let's see, labeled the way that I want them. This has been so invaluable. It's got the paint number, the color, and a little swatch, and just a great addition to my organization system. Oh, so what I'm going to want to do, I had to get out more black paint because I want to paint the back side. And the reason I'm going to paint the back side is just in case I want variables in, like, does the chicken stand to the right or to the left? But I also don't want the back to be like showing, but then at least not be black. It should not just be raw wood back there, because if it sticks out and it's on my counter, it might look kind of tacky. So I'll go ahead and either finish the back or paint both sides. You can decide for you which is right, but I do think you should at least paint the back black. Okay, now that I have my lines on here, they're a little bit too strong, and what I was dealing with is a brand new piece of graphite paper, so I'm going to go ahead and soften all of my lines right now to a point where I can barely see them using a triple threat eraser, and I'll just get them smudged down so that they're not screaming at me, and I know that they're going to be able to be toned down. Alright, I've got my stencil on here for my words. I want to make sure that I'm stopping and starting in the same. Yeah, that's what I thought. I'm just a little bit wonky here. I've got a T-square. Yeah, it's not far off. I bet you it won't show too much. Okay, so we're going to use some gold powders. I'm going to use the gold, which comes, these are actual metal filings in powder form. I'm going to mix a little bit of my bronze in, just a hair of it. How pretty that bronze color is. Can you see? It's got like a little redhead look to it. I just don't like the gold quite so bright. So I'm just going to mix it with a little bit of matte varnish. Any clear medium works. So watch how pretty when that activates. You just mix it in. The neat thing about the powders instead of a metallic paint is you can decide how thick to make it. So if you want a sheer color, then you just do a little teeny bit. And if you want it to base coat all in one, the first coat, then you go ahead and put more powder in with it. Now I'll go in and grab just a little bit of that bronze, just to tone that down. I just don't like screaming gold. I love that we have control of it when we're using the powders. And you can mix it with silver, you can mix it with all kinds of stuff. All right, so I've got my tacket on the back of this. I've got my chalkboard paint done. I'm going to go ahead and just stipple into this using an ink sweeper. And I'm going to be careful not to go over my edge. Okay. And we'll give it two coats, and then I'll take my stencil off. Alright, we're going to dry brush. What I've got is Patty's favorite dry brush. It is an oval brush, and this is a number 2, so it's really tiny. We're going to load by pulling just out from the pile of paint out onto our palette, and I'm not going to do it by pulling a whole pile. I'm just going to sneak it out. I'm going to rotate my brush a little bit back and forth, kind of rock it to keep it flat. I don't want to build up paint on my edges, and as soon as I get a wad of paint on the top, then I know that I've got enough paint on there. The bottom is going to be flat, so this is dry brushing. This is going to leave dry, scratchy marks on our piece. And with dry brushing, we don't base coat, we just highlight. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start from the bottom down here where I can't quite tell what's going on. I'll pretend like there's something going on right there. And I'm just going to streak, and you'll notice that you can't really see what I've done. Each subsequent layer is going to build on the other one. We're going to keep a dry paper towel that is flat, and we're going to flick on our paper towel as we make our strokes. Okay, and I'll try and keep both of these on camera for you. Let me get jockeyed around. Okay, so sometimes it just won't show very much, so it's just a couple little strokes for each of these little, they almost look like dragon scales to me. Flick. Okay, as I load, I'll always flick, and then as I get lighter and lighter, this is going to be a series of highlights, I'm going to see where I need to go back and close things up, because I'll leave little kind of black little bullet holes, I call them, and you'll see what I mean when we get going. Okay, so this is just a little repeat. What's nice about, the steps are just repeats. What's nice about this technique is it's very relaxing. There's not a whole lot of skill that's needed. This is the dry brushing that Joe Sonia and Bobby Takashima and Rosemary West do. This isn't dry rubbing where you rouge things with a dry scumbly brush. This is more to make an old master's look of dried paint. Okay, so I think I've got all of them done. Get this little guy. Sometimes you have to turn your brush in the corner. Now note what I'm going to do next is I'm going to wipe my brush off. And I'm going to load into the next paint without washing my brush. Okay, and because I already got paint in there, it doesn't take very long to load the second time. And we just do this whole thing dirty brushed. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead. This is going to not go up quite as high as the last one. And so now you should be able to start seeing what I've done. A very small movement right here because this piece is not huge. I did paint, I painted a number of items with number fours and number two brushes. So it's possible to do even large items. You just have to make more little strokes. Okay, and you'll see on my palette that my paints are laid out in a highlight sequence. I'm going to go from the darkest to the lightest. And that's going to be the same for every color that I do. Okay, so now I'll look at it and see if I'm getting any kind of definition, and I see that I am getting some definition. I'm not happy with my middle color choice here. This is like a yellow-green, and then this is a bright yellow-green. This seems muddy somehow, so I'm going to go get another color out. Okay, so I've gone into leaf green. Okay, and so with the leaf green, woof! Alright, we're going to go into our avocado and our leaf and make sure that we have a little bit of muddy. That was just a little too bold. I'm going to muddy our colors together, so it'll be a dirty brush, really dirty brush mix of the two colors. We want this scratchy and dry. We do not want this ultra juicy. Definitely dry. And the scratches will allow the other colors to show through, and it will give it a really nice blended look. Okay, so you can kind of start seeing his little feather pattern. Go and make some pretend things where you see empty holes. Okay, if it's not enough, then you go back and give it a little bit more and close up the gaps. You can go backwards a color. If you make a mistake with dry brushing, you just go back one layer, and that will fix everything. Okay, so if I wanted to go backwards one, I could go dirty brush into this green and just work on closing up some of the black. Okay, now I'll wipe my brush out and I'll go into my brighter green, which is festive green. And I think I'll make sure that I'm going to dirty brush with that. And then these I'm going to start just highlighting the front of the breast of the chicken. I won't do this color everywhere. This is going to be the highlight color. And so that should start making the breast appear to stick out just a little bit. Okay, let me squint at it and take a look. I'll repeat with that color. Look on my paper towel, it's coming off just a little too much. And I won't repeat with as much paint as I did before. Okay, so now that starts looking about right. I can walk the colors in just a little bit. I'll flip my bird upside right and see what he looks like. Upside right for me, that is. And it looks like right here in this area I have a little bit of a bullet hole or a void. So I'll go into plantation pine and I'll just close a couple of the voids up just a little bit. It's easy enough to do. The other thing I need to do is go erase my lines. So I'll get an eraser and I'll erase all the in-between lines. All right, we're gonna do his lower leg next. We're gonna go into burnt umber, load our brush. We're gonna use a sequence that's going to be burnt umber, milk chocolate, honey brown, camel, and mustard seed. You don't necessarily have to use every color every time. Look on my paper towel. And we'll just go start filling these in. Just exactly like we did with the breast colors. Okay, at the bottom and at the edges, you have to make sure that you finish it nicely. Otherwise, it won't look like it closes up for his leg. Okay, then we'll repeat with the other colors in the sequence, just like on the green breast feathers. And I pull up some of that color into, just yeah, that was a big blank hole right there. It's hard to see with the dark on the dark. Okay, I've got out my artist buddy, which is elevating this project, so it's a little bit slanted. And I'm hoping that you'll be able to see what my hand is doing a little bit better. So I'm gonna go see that little hole right there. I'm gonna go ahead and fill that in. Now I'm going to wipe my brush out and I'm going to load into milk chocolate, dirty brush. I just wipe off the excess of the burnt umber. Sometimes the color will be very strong and you want to be careful not to have too much in your brush because it'll take over the next color. So I'll reach out and just do the dry brush so it's nice and scratchy and dry looking. Just repeat on all of the little guys. See how they start just kind of appearing. And this is self-shading because the black is the first value of shading, then the burnt umber, and then the milk chocolate. Okay. This would be a really good time to erase your lines. I'm going to go into honey brown next. I could, in theory, go into milk chocolate, it looks like, one more time. My chicken doesn't look very milk chocolate-like. Now I'm going to start focusing where the brighter colors are going to be, and that would be in the middle of the leg. That'll be where it bends out. Okay, I'm going to wipe my brush out just a little bit. I can go backwards and repeat just with that one color. So notice I'm just not spending as much time on each one. And I think my camel's gonna be too bright. I think camel's not the right color, so I'm gonna get out cocoa. Camel almost has a white look, and I feel like it's going to make my chicken look like it had blonde streaks put in it, like platinum blonde. Okay, so I've got cocoa in my brush. And I'm going to just give a couple of little scratchy highlights, a real gentle touch. Do not press on your brush. Okay, just really soft. I can repeat where I want to. Okay, so that gives me just that little bit of extra. I'm just going to give a feather kiss of color to the others. And then maybe we'll get a little bit stronger in the middle. Maybe a little bit of something up there. And we'll go into a touch of the mustard seed dirty brush. And give that just a little bit of that yellow color. Okay. That might be just a little too bright. So notice I just kind of press on it with my finger, and that helps a lot. Okay, so next we're going to do his arm feathers. I'll wipe out the brush. We could do the arm feathers all at the same time as the leg feathers. But leg feathers, you know what I mean. Okay, so we'll do exactly the same technique. And then we also have some of these feathers down here. Okay, so what we'll do with these guys, I'll show you these. These are going to be exactly the same as you just did here. So let me show you down here. These little guys, we're just going to long stroke them, starting with the burnt umber. Leave some space where there is, where the lines go. You want to have that black show through. If the black doesn't show through, then you don't have any shading. Okay, let's just go right through those saddle feathers. And I can't decide about these guys right here. I have to do maybe a little research on that. So I'll wipe out my brush. I'll go into milk chocolate. Flick on my paper towel. And I'll forward this just towards the front. I'm almost turning my brush just so that it's just highlighting towards the front. Wipe out my brush into honey brown. Yeah, that's right. Okay, and this is actually not even dry between. So now I'm doing it towards the middle of these feathers. Okay, so that just gives him just a nice little feathery. I'm going to give him a little bit wider feathers. Fill them in a little bit. Okay, he also has these neck feathers, which we can do in the same sequence, except for we're going to use a little bit of yellow to finish that off. That's going to keep our center of interest in this area. Okay, so we're burnt umber. Okay, and then we want to go over the top of his head in a very nice, natural look. Okay, so that gets that top little crown of his. And then we're going to, I'll jog him to the side here. We're going to curve that as it comes down. Okay, and we're going to start making these kind of into little clusters. They're shaped a little bit like a long U. Okay, so they're wide at the side, like a football kind of, but a really long one. Okay, so we're going to have some feathers. We know we're going to have feathers down here. And we'll do just a shape following kind of thing. Come down here and pull these over his breast. We know we're going to have some over here because that's the cut of the wood. I'm just going to fill it. Whoops, skipped over to the wrong color. And you've got a couple of tries with this to get it right, so don't feel like you have to do it all at one time. Okay, so that's kind of cute. So now we'll go into, wiping our brush out, we'll go into milk chocolate. It's amazing how not hard this is. Other kinds of painting where you have to shade and highlight and do all this stuff is just kind of draggish after you do a couple of dry brush projects. Don't worry about your eye. You're going to fill that in, so you don't have to worry about keeping it all like perfect. We know that we have. So see how you can see through and see the scratches? That's what you want. If it's solid, then you're doing too heavy a hand. Okay. Okay. So up here, we don't have very much of something going on. I'm gonna wipe my brush out. And it's off to honey brown. Okay, and so then honey brown, we're gonna come over the top of his little noodle here. Don't wanna cover everything up. These are just highlights that go on top of the color we've already done. Got a blot if your hand gets too heavy. So all this done so far with just one brush, which makes it cheap to do as well, or affordable, we'll use that word. Great class for beginners, because beginners don't know what you know. Beginners don't know that they don't have to shade and highlight, so they're just flicking with the brush and they feel very successful. All right, and we'll head off over to Cocoa. And give us a couple of nice, strong, liney highlights. Sometimes I turn my brush on its chisel. And then that's going to give me a little bit more of a liney look, which I like. If I want it to look blended, then I use it on its flat. Now I'll go into the mustard seed. Dirty brush. Flick on the paper towel. And then that's going to give him his golden crown, kind of. That'll just yellow him up nicely. And so notice that it just takes like one flick for each area. And then we really need to come down here and give a kiss of that. Down here. Walk our colors around. We could have just a little bit more. Gotta do it upside down. If you're pulling towards you, you have to flip your piece. So you can pull to you. Okay. So he's getting to be looking kind of dapper. Now I have to finish up here, so I'll go ahead and finish that and figure out what we're going to do with this. Okay, I'm going to work on his comb and his wattle and stuff like that. I've got Alizarin Crimson, and I think I probably wanted a different color, but we'll try this one first. Yeah, I think I'm going to need Deep Burgundy. Okay, Alizarin Crimson is just too transparent to do this, so I'm going to go ahead and bring Deep Burgundy down. I'm going to do kind of shape following movements. This is as close to a base coat as we're going to get. It's just going to be like shape following and kind of fill it in, but leaving some open stuff. So it's just feather tickles all the way down to where it joins. And just change your shape following, and then your subsequent streaks will be shape following, and that will make it be more dry brushed. Okay, flick on the paper towel. Now I will pull up towards his face. Towards his beak, and then filling in the middle. Get that up there, all the way to the edge. Okay, now his eye is 2 footballs. Okay, so I'm gonna switch to my smaller brush and do deep burgundy. There's an inner football and an outer football. Okay, so the inner football is going to be, let me see if I can get his eye positioned correctly, just with a chisel. Okay, so that looks like a little football. And then the outer one is not going to touch all the way over to there. It'll go around it. And then we'll meet that in the back here. Okay. So now you have an inner and an innie and an outie there. I can repeat with my red if I don't think I've got it dark enough, and I think I want it a little bit more vibrant. Okay, but I'm not going to bring it down as far. So I'm going to treat this just like another color. Make sure you get it on the tips, though. That is necessary. Okay, so that's getting nice and red. Same thing here. Just going to repeat, but we're not going to bring it up as far. Give that a little shadow look. Switch to my smaller brush. Repeat. And repeat. And then repeat on the inner circle. Okay, now I'm going to wipe out my brush. We're going to pick up the next color, which is Country Red. Load. Nice juicy paint. And we'll go ahead and highlight right here if we can. Not bringing that back as far at all. And do the, get a little bit of a glare. Do the little football. Then we'll see if we can use this same brush to highlight. Okay, so now I'm going to anchor my hand. And we're definitely not going to pull that down as far. And we're going to start leaving spaces between the highlights. Okay, we'll see how this settles down. If it doesn't settle down, we'll put a little glaze over it. Seems a little bit sudden and bold. But that might just be what we needed. Okay, get this little waddle thing going there. Okay, next, I think that's settling down okay. I think we can dig it. Next, we'll go into Dirty Brush, into the Coral Blush. Important that it is Dirty Brush, otherwise you're gonna look like you're bright pink on top of everything that you're doing. Okay, now this is just, whoops, that's wet. This is just like a little line, so real soft pressure. Okay, so see how that's getting highlighted. Okay, and then the same thing up here, just a feather-like touch, and my paint is still wet. I can see the shine marks on it. So we're just going to give just a little bit of that highlight. And we are going to go back over and do just a little bit of glazing, so don't worry that you're getting too pink or too pink. Okay, and then we'll highlight right up the middle of this little waddle to give it like that dimension. Okay, it looks a little funny with a black beak right now. Okay, so I think that that's probably good. Let's try a little bit of Hot Shots. So this is neons, they're calling them these days. This is fiery red. And so what this is a very fluorescent acrylic, and they make them in like 5 colors. So you can use the Hot Shots Fiery Red or the Neon Fiery Red over your red colors, and it will kind of make them brighter without making them brighter, if that makes any sense. And so then it's just like a perfect little highlight for them. Okay, and they're very transparent. So we'll go over this. And we'll give it just that little neon tickle. Okay. And it vivids everything up. So see how this is very milky and this is kind of vivid. I don't like the milky. Red is a really hard color to manage anyway. So that just vivided it up. Okay, so we've got that. Now we'll go in to a flat brush. Okay, we'll go into a flat brush and the Alizarin. And we'll go ahead and just side load. Okay, and I want this to be a little bit yummy on the back end and over his crown. So the neons made everything more vivid, and then the Alizarin will make everything redder. Just gives it some life. Okay. So we'll go ahead and see how that feels, and I think we're going to need to do a little bit with our green down here as well. Alright, after some research, I've landed on blue, but I'm not sure that this blue is going to be the one that I can make it work with. So we'll see. We'll see where we get. We might have to go backwards a step. So we want to overlap the bottom. One thing that I didn't tell you is you want to do these lower pieces before you do the upper pieces so that you can layer them over the top. Okay, and notice that I left that kind of fuzzy looking band right there. That's so that it looks like it's shaded already. I'll bring it up just a little bit. It's a little too much left alone. Now what will bring this blue in is that I'll tint around with the color. So now I'll go into my next color. So that was Victorian. Then I'll go into Calypso. And I'm not sure I can bring this much brighter, but I'm going to go into Desert Turquoise just to give it a more teal look. Okay, and then I think I'm going to dry that out of my brush, and I'm going to go into a little bit of Desert Teal. Am I doing it right? Desert Turquoise, sorry. And tickle on some of these greens so that they're a little bit more bottle green. Okay, now I'm starting that to carry that color around. And I think I'll go ahead and do just a little bit more. Okay, and then maybe we can go backwards into our darkest green, not the darkest, but the one up from that, the evergreen. And maybe we can go ahead and go into the blue, the dark side of the blue, and give it some green. So now we've got the two colors dancing in and out of that area. Okay, I think I can dig it. Now we'll go back here and build this tail. And I think our tail is going to start with the green, so I'm going to go into the black green. And I've got my brush dirty from the other colors. I'm not worried about that. The more you can't tell what's going on, the happier you'll be with these feathers and stuff. Okay, so we just want to smear some black green, which isn't as dark as the black, in that tail. Shape following strokes. Make sure your tail strokes stay graceful. Okay, and so we'll go next. and keep that separation between the two, or between them all. Okay, and just give a little bit of hoopla back there and fill in with whatever that's going to be. Wipe out your brush, go into the evergreen. So that was black green into evergreen. And I think I might be able to work a little bit in both directions. I want to build the green down at the bottom, and I'm going to have it just like the wing here, with the green at the base and then the teal more at the tip. So I'm not going to worry about those tips right now. Just get that out there, and I think I'm going to go ahead and let that dry. All right, while I'm waiting for that to dry, I'm going to go into milk chocolate and get his beak in there so he isn't black beak anymore. Black beak, the bearded pirate chicken. Okay, there we go. And then we'll go into honey. And I really should be working from the front in. You're going to leave the strongest color when you put your brush down. So you want to make sure that you allow for that. And then I'm going to skip over to mustard seed. Okay, I don't know that I have that yellow enough just yet. Now I do know that my colors are not as vibrant as I want them. My blue is taking over the world right here. So it's time to go and beef up some of my colors. And it might be that that yellow that I've just got, the mustard seed on my brushes, are just a little too bold. So I'm going to go ahead and put it around, but then I'm going to go backwards and pick up a little bit of my camel color mixed with my cocoa color with the dirty brush of the mustard seed. And I'll go in next to that mustard seed and give it just a few highlights that aren't so yellow. And we have a little bit of a bullet situation, bullseye kind of going on right there. That is caused by my paints being wet when I put on the subsequent highlights. So I'm going to go back to the highlight color dirty brush into coral blush and dry that off a little bit more. And I'm going to build that highlight back up. And I could go ahead and, if I wanted to, beef up highs of some different other things. Okay, we can go back to our yellow and see if we can't mix a little bit of the camel with the mustard seed. For the mustard seed is very transparent. So we'll see if we can't get it a little bit more wah, like that, but not so much. Okay, but now it shows. And then maybe we can use that same mix too. So that makes me a little bit happier. He's a little bit bolder. We need to do something in here. So we'll go into cocoa with the green. Not cool. My brush went through the... See what's nice about this nonstick mat? This is up at, gosh, I don't know what degree this is, 35 degrees maybe. It's up at a good high bunch of degrees, and my piece isn't slipping because I've got the nonstick mat on it, but I can get a really good angle. I'm not having a problem with the glaring right now, so that's really good. Sometimes these tools are just like things you don't think of until you use them, and then you're just thrilled. Okay, so I think I like that. That's a little bit brighter right there. And I think I'll spread some of that around down here as well. And make sure you're using the right side of your brush. I almost use the loaded side of my brush instead of the flat side of my brush. Okay, that's that back leg. We'll have to shade to make that be standing out and doing what it's supposed to be doing. We'll go ahead and shade this lower part of this wing. Okay, and these are our saddle feathers. We'll get to those in just a minute. And I think we can take this color out of my brush and go into the Indian turquoise. And I think my blue is glowing a little bit, and I think it's because of the value of it. By putting a little white on it, it's going to glow in a different way. So we're going to just do a couple of little streaks. And then we'll do the same thing on this bottle green color that we're playing with right here. Give them some streaks so that they look feathery. And I think we can give a little bit of our, let's go to Indian turquoise plus the desert turquoise plus Indian turquoise, and give our red just a little bit of highlight with that. Okay, and I think we can go into desert turquoise, and we can do the same thing with the highlights there. Give a little bit of that same stuff to this wing thing here. Okay, now we'll go back to our tail feather. I'm going to switch to my bigger brush, and we're going to go into evergreen, which is our next darker color. Click on the paper towel, and real streaky-like, bring it in, drag it in, reload as you need it. Now we'll go into our lighter green, which is the leaf, I'm pretty certain. And we'll increase the brightness of that. And we can do a little bit of that green, that lighter green here too, where that came out. And then maybe even beef up some of our greens down here. It was a nice little tap dance. You just kind of balance the colors out as you go. Get that up and over its transition point right there. Okay, now we switch into, wipe out your brush, and switch into the blues. So we'll go Victorian Calypso. And we'll give him that nice pretty tail. And we streak that down in. A little bit like an S stroke. So you can do establish the tail and then streak it in on the edge of your
my brush. He's got a little bit of a flip here, so we have to do a double whammy. You want pretty lines when you're doing this. Okay, so I've got to make sure that I transition from that one flip to a pretty flip. Going that way. All right, now we wipe our brush, go into Calypso, and back at the top. Now we're going to start streaking a little bit more. Okay, the tip, there we go. Get the tip nice and solid, sort of, and then streak. Definitely want some streaks. No brush is quite made like this Patty's Favorite Dry Brush. It is capable of doing all these streaks and filling things in and holding its chisel when fully loaded. It's a pretty cool little brush. I searched for a long time to find it. Oops, it's in the wrong color. Okay, so the same thing here. Keep our pretty shape. And then add some streaks. Okay, so I'm going to wipe out my brush and I'm going to go hop over to our brighter green, just dirty brush, which is festive. And I want to bring some of our brighter green up into his tail. Because that just wasn't bright enough. We can go and bring a little bit of that green into his lower area down here too. Pop it up a little bit. Okay, he's getting some balance. Okay, so see how that blue is just kind of a weird neon blue. So once we go into these turquoises, then that's going to help. I've got just a little bit of green in my brush from doctoring the breast, and that's going to be perfect. So now I really want some streaks. And they're all completely green, so let's wipe that out a little bit more. Desert turquoise. And that's almost not even light enough to show. Okay, so wipe that out and into Indian turquoise. Nice little spin on things. This one I think I'm going to drag out. And then drag this guy over. Remember, those two are at the bottom, so if they get too light, that's going to be not correct. Okay, so now let's doctor. Got to bring some of my teals into my greens. round some things off.
And we need to do a little glaze of something or another on top of that. I go over this. Okay. And we'll go into his saddle feathers. All right, we're going to go into our burnt umber. And we're just going to kind of fill in, sort of, feathers. Keep it kind of raspy and feathery instead of base coaty. You want to be able to see the black between. Lead with your chisel, that way you're ending up on your chisel instead of leading with the flat of your brush. So I'll get it fatter at the beginning, but then it'll get narrower at the top and clunkier. Okay, now that line has to come over the top of his little back here. Okay, so we want to make sure that we're bringing it along the correct way. And so it has to just kind of scooch along and then drop. And then scooch along and then drop. Okay, that makes me a little happier. Okay, then we're gonna drop into milk chocolate. And scooch along and drop in. Whoops. Drop in. I'm not getting a very good movement with my angle of my brush. Scooch along and drop in. Don't bring these all the way out because I want to drag them back up. Okay, so then we'll go down here at the bottom and scooch them up with just some wispies. That color out into honey brown. While I have honey brown on my paintbrush, I'm going to mark my label so that I know what color that is. I kept looking at it thinking it wasn't the right color. That's those colors on top of the paint bottle labels are brilliant. Okay, so now we're going to make that come along. Just real dry and airy. And then we'll go give it a few more feather marks coming up from the bottom. That just brings it all together, doesn't it? Now we're down into the cocoa color. And the same thing here. We're going to give that just some accents. I think we might be about there. This looks a little bit lonely to me, so I'm going to take it back to this cocoa color and just see if I think that's the color it was. I'll just warm it up just a little bit. And we'll try some glazes. So we'll get into our flat brush. And I think we need some other colors. Okay, we're gonna do some different streaks of different colors. I've got Prussian blue, and I wanna just warm up the shadow side of our tail feathers to give it just another color in there. So I've got just a wash,
I'm just going to float that along, but not over everything, just under where, under the bottom part of that. So this is glazing because it's changing the colors under, but it's not taking over. To glaze, you need to have a really transparent color. So I think that looks a little richer. Okay, now we'll go into our wingy feathers and warm them up just a little bit too. And then we'll go in with a blue, with the Holly Plus Prussian, and we'll go ahead and shade next to the body with that color and under the breast, giving that just a little bit of a tone that we borrowed from the blue and the green. We'll go into Russet, and we're going to warm up the wing and red up the wing just a little bit. That wing was looking really lonely. I think we have a little bit more work to do on it. Okay, we'll do the same thing with the leg. And maybe just a little bit on his tail feathers. And we can maybe dig a little bit of that into his upper feathers here so that he's not a lonely color. Okay. Now, what we do from here is we go in and adjust just a little bit more. Get all my brushes are in the water. We'll go with our smallest brush and go into the Indian Turquoise and flick on the paper towel. Okay, and now we'll go ahead and give just a hairy, feathery stuff. And I really want it to kind of overlap over here, but I want it kept really hairy and feathery. Okay, then I want to go into his tail feathers and I want to do the same thing at the top of the arch of wherever the tail feather is bending. That's not giving me exactly how much I want. I may have to bump it up to a new color. Okay, maybe that's okay. And then I'm going to wipe this brush out and I'm going to go into my cocoa and marigold. I need just a little bit. Marigold's too bright for down there, so we'll go back up to his neck feathers. We'll make these really drop over and lengthen his neck just a little bit. Make some of these really drop over. Okay, and then let's give a little kiss of that on his saddle feathers. Okay, so that just brightens it just ever so much. And let's see, do we need to do any more? We need to get him an eyeball. So we'll go into lamp black. And we'll just get him a nice little eyeball, and then we'll give him a little dot of white. Okay, so he always gets his little dot of white, and then maybe his little beak can have a little smudge of white as well. His comb might have some little highlight light things. His little
feet can have a little bit more. All right, while I've got his tail there and his and the white out and a liner brush, let's go ahead and mix the Indian turquoise with the white. About maybe two blue to one white. And let's give him a little bit more, I want a little bit more feathery tail. Okay, just a few, I want a little bit more texture, I think is what I'm wanting. So I don't really want it highlighted as much as I want it textured. So notice that those didn't follow any kind of pretty anything. Okay, give them a couple more textures down here. And maybe just a little bit more with the highlight textures in his. Maybe a little bit got our blue getting away from us by doing that. So let's go pick it up with our camel that we said we didn't want to use earlier. Camel with some water in our liner. And let's give our texture feathers back here. Okay, so that's going to give us just that little bit. Down his back. This is where we get to have fun. A little bit more water, a little bit more yellow. This is camel. So now his red in his beak area is looking a little bit duller. But this is how you build things. Don't worry about, you know, having to do the steps a couple of times. I think this is the fun part, is like, okay, do I need, you know, this piece of jewelry, or do I need a necklace to make this outfit look cute? That's kind of what we're doing now, is accessorizing with the colors. So go into, I'm just going to flatten my brush into the coral blush. And we'll go into his eye and his inner eye. And just build that just a little bit more. Okay, now we need to do his legs. Okay, I'm going to use my Ghost Writer, which is just a three stencil, a pencil lead, to do my details on his foot. This will just chalk this on, and then I don't have to trace. Okay, and his toe seems to be, this has got an eraser right there on the end, so I can just erase right off of there. And pop that puppy right in the middle, more where it belongs. Okay, so the triple thread has a gray lead that's ceramic, and a roller ball for tracing, a white lead for that is ceramic, and then it's got a super soft grip, and it's got the eraser on the end, a super duper handy tool. Okay, so we're gonna go into our browns. I'm gonna do burnt umber first, and these guys are all gonna be smiling up at Mr. Chicken. And we're just gonna do a series of like C's, okay, that don't quite overlap, because what we're gonna do is stagger them. Okay, when we get down here to the bottom, we have to change our angle. So I'm gonna go ahead and get his other leg done first.
Hope you're enjoying this different kind of style of painting. It definitely, it'll change a lot of the way that you think about different kinds of techniques. Okay, so then we want little ones for his toes. We don't want too much detail on his feet because we don't want his feet to take over. And I don't think very many people really like chicken feet anyway. So we'll keep the charm away from the chicken feet. Okay, now we'll go into our next color. It's always with the sequins. We're going to go to milk chocolate. And we're going to keep this within the boundary of the leg itself. We don't want to go from side to side like we did with the burnt umber. So we'll just keep this within and kind of just go down his leg just a little bit. And we'll switch angles and go down his little toesies. And the same thing here. Okay, I'm wiping that out and going into honey brown. And the honey brown's gonna be the exact same thing. Wow, hello, did you see that? Okay, somebody got into a little bit of the, let's see, that was not honey brown, that was camel. The colors are a little bit close side by side. So yeah, whoopsie. Down his leg, and now we can just smooth down his toe. We don't have to keep going with that the C strokes. Oops, the brush has still got some of that camel in it. Transition it up his leg, now into cocoa, and that'll be the final yellow it up color. And this is getting smaller. And skinnier. It'll give roundness to his feet. So, I think we can call this, whoops, a done deal. I think that that is going to be just fine. Just checking them over. Yeah. All right, we know we want to have the Cucina in the red. So we're going to go ahead and Cucina red. And so we'll just do our stipple thing and get nice and base coated all around. I don't know that I'm going to want Bella in that, and I'm not sure how I'm going to handle that with this stipply stuff. I'll figure it out. This is using the Italian sash brush. And make sure you turn your brush from side to side. And I think I'm going to do this whole bottom band in the red as well. All right, I've got my Bella Cucina word based with my deep burgundy. Going to go into country red and use the crescent brushes so that what we're going to do is we're going to dry rub from the top down and make a kind of a fade. So you dry off all the paint on your brush
And if you don't quite dry it off, then you can do some streaks. Okay, so you can kind of rub and streak at the same time. And don't bring it maybe all the way down. I haven't done one of these with the letters like this before, so I'm not sure what I'm doing. Yeah, I'll see. So we get it nice and solid at the top and then streak it down. More, so repeat it one more time. Same thing under E. Okay, now I think we're going to reverse it and bring the dark color up. All right, I mixed a little bit of soft black in with my deep burgundy. And so we'll go on the bottom of the letters. We'll see what darkening them does. And it may be that we want to mix just a little bit more of that in there. And it may be that we want to just dry brush instead of dry rub these so that they'll show a little better. Okay, so I'm not sure yet. So I'm drying it off enough so it's not a base coat. We'd have to crisp that up, but that was going to be the case. So let's see. Okay, and we'll just repeat to the rest of the letters. All right, I'm going to try dotting the C and the other lower letters. I'm going to use the bigger dot tool, I think. With autumn, is it autumn? No, it's country red. Kind of trying to keep this simple, but kind of make it fun. Wipe off your tool as the dots change sizes so that you keep things uniform. Okay, I'm going to go back with my smaller dot tool and wake it up. And I'm going to put little smaller dots on my bigger dots. Just put them right on in there. Just make them stand out. Just totally couldn't see that, sorry. Make them stand out just a little bit more. I don't want them to take over.
want there to be a little bit more something going on. Be slightly off center. All right, so we're going to try using soft black that's thinned. We're going to try doing a little diagonal moment going on here. Try to carry them on where they can go across a couple of letters. Okay. Okay, I found this cute little metallic emblem to put on the top, and I'm going to go ahead and line down the sides with a compass, not quite wide enough. This is a half pipe compass. It has, there we go. It has a lovely lid on it so that you don't stab yourself. Okay, now I'll tape this and I'll use the metallic paint that matches this little emblem. So I'll just mix the gold and the statuary bronze or whatever to make them match. Okay, we're going to use the gold color. We're going to blot on our paper towel so we don't bleed under. And then we're just going to use these ink sweepers for just a little bit of gold coming down. I don't need this line very base coaty, so I'm going to go ahead and peel my tape, see what I think. That as it comes across the top right there. I'll give that a little bit of a base coat and see what I think. And that kind of makes it look like it's flowing off the top. Okay, and repeat.